charm of their own. They provide entertainment and thrill to all those who watch and play it. Take a closer look at any game such as cricket, billiards, or cycling. Well, we observe that it is not easy to play a game unless you know the rules of the game. Most of us are also aware that every game has a technique of playing it.
Again, take a closer look. Viewers, did you see the motion of the ball or the spin of the ball? Did you observe the effect of collision of the two balls? In other words, if we try to explore the basic intricacies of some games, then we realize that the basic laws in physics are involved. Isn't it surprising? In fact, most of the games, like billiards, cricket, and cycling, are all based on the basic principles in physics.
Motion of a large number of objects of different kinds is the most commonly occurring phenomenon in nature. Since earliest times, man has been trying to analyze the different aspects of motion and to determine the principles governing them. A peep into the history, perhaps, will reveal the contributions of some of the great minds who, with their distinguished scientific genius, changed the times on the earth. That was the indication of evolution of human mind, which further influenced the next generations who saw the dawn of the scientific era. Undoubtedly, the Greek philosopher-scientist Aristotle was the first to suggest a quantitative law of motion. We cannot neglect the works of Thomas Bradwardine, Jean Bourdillon, and William of Ockham in classical mechanics. The next stage of development took place in the arena of celestial mechanics. The Polish astronomer Nicholas Copernicus put forward the heliocentric theory of the solar system. No longer after Copernicus' death, the Danish nobleman Tycho de Brahe began a series of observations on Mars and other planets, but died before he could analyze the data. It was one of his young assistants, Johann Kepler, who, having got access to these data, could finally formulate his three celebrated laws of planetary motion. While Kepler was busy in formulating these laws, Galileo Galilei, the famous Italian scientist, made a telescope in 1610. It was around 1638 that he finally formulated the three laws of falling bodies. In 1632, he published the principle of conservation of motion on any frictionless horizontal plane. This law is referred to as the Galilean law of inertia. Following this spirit of scientific investigation, Europe soon became the birthplace of practically all scientific and technological developments that were to follow. Later times saw the contribution of many philosophers and physicists. However, Sir Isaac Newton, the greatest scientific genius of all time, was the first to successfully explain not only Kepler's laws of motion, but also myriads of other phenomena and problems of that time. The study of motion and its causes forms an important branch of physics called mechanics.
Based upon large amount of work which had been carried out over earlier centuries, Newton had formulated the laws of motion, the law of gravitation, and had studied the motion of particles. The major book in three volumes that he had written, the Philosophy Naturalis Principia Mathematica, in short known as Principia Mathematica, was published in 1687. This work is said to be the most original and creative work produced by a single individual. The mathematical problem-solving methods that Newton had formulated are in use even today. The gravitational theory that he had formulated is being continuously used in all the space flights and space explorations.
As we all know, billiards is an indoor game played on a rectangular table. The table measures 12 feet by 6 feet 1.5 inches. The game snooker is also played on the same table. In both these games, players shoot at balls made up of a chemical compound. The balls are made up of supercrystalline. A long tapered stick called the cue is used to hit the ball. The length of the cue generally varies from 3 feet to 4 feet 10 inches. The tip of the cue is made of leather. A chalk is applied onto the cue to prevent what we call a miscue. The table has got 6 pockets. Pocket number 1, pocket number 2, pocket number 3, pocket number 4, pocket number 5, and pocket number 6. These are the bottom pockets, the center pockets, and the two top pockets.
The study of motion and its causes forms an important branch of physics called mechanics. Newton's laws of motion are of fundamental importance in physics, and they form the basis of classical mechanics. Let's find out how the game billiards is based on the Newton's laws of motion. Newton's first law. Every inanimate body continues in its state of rest or of uniform motion along a straight line unless it is acted upon by an external unbalanced force. A player who is playing billiards without knowing uses the basic principles of physics.
It is our common experience that a body at rest on earth does not move of its own accord. You leave a body in one place and it will remain there unless it is acted upon by some external force. Like in billiards, for example, a ball at rest does not move unless you hit it with the cue. The second part of the law is rather difficult to grasp because at a first glance it appears to be contrary to our observations. In the case of cycling, for example, if you stop pedaling, the bicycle starts slowing down. Here we are expecting that the uniform motion should have continued, but the bicycle stops or bicycle starts slowing down. You may therefore conclude that a constant force is required to maintain the uniform motion of the bicycle. However, this is not a correct observation since we are neglecting here 2 to 3 forces which are acting on the bicycle as well as the person who is pedaling. These forces are the force of friction between the bicycle tire and the surface of the road, as well as the drag or the resistance, which is equivalent to the friction offered by air to the body of the cyclist as well as to the frame of the bicycle. Both these forces oppose the forward motion of the bicycle. It is due to these forces that the bicycle comes to rest after you stop pedaling. If it were possible to eliminate the effect of friction as well as the air resistance, you would have found that pedaling was not necessary to maintain the uniform motion of the bicycle. In space, when a satellite moves in the orbit, after having been given the initial velocity, it will remain there in the orbit because it is not being acted by any kind of a air resistance or drag. Under those circumstances, there is no loss of energy, and since there is no loss of energy, the uniform motion continues. The tabletop of a billiards table has to be perfectly leveled for ensuring uniform motion. If the table surface is not leveled properly, say like this, towards the slope, then the ball will be accelerated by the gravity. And if the top is like this, away from the slope, then the ball is retarded. For this reason, the heavy slate tabletop is incorporated in a heavy and strong wooden frame. The top is covered with a tightly stretched West of England woolen cloth which has a thickish nap. When Q hits the ball, there is only a point contact between the ball and the cue. Depending upon where exactly the cue hits the ball, it will result in either a rolling motion or a spinning motion. One must understand that as there is very small friction between the ball and the tabletop, rolling or spinning motion is possible. In the case of the billiards, the ball hits the side of the table. Now, if you were to observe the side of the table properly, you will see that there also only a point contact takes place between the ball as well as the side of the table. This is slightly different compared to what happens in the case of carom. There, the entire side of the carom piece will hit the side of the carom board. There will be a line contact, not a point contact. In the case of billiards, there is going to be a point contact. In billiards, the cue has a very peculiar shape. Take a look at the cue. The tip of the cue has a particular curvature. The billiards ball also has a particular curvature. The specific shape is such that it will finally result in a point contact. We do not want to have a large surface contact. It should not result in a push, but it should result in a quick force being delivered to the ball. Thus, a body at rest has a tendency to remain at rest, and a body in motion has a tendency to remain in the state of uniform motion unless there is an external force acting on the body. It is as if every material body is unwilling to change its motion on its own. It requires an external force for any change to take place. The effect produced by a moving body depends not only on its mass or its velocity, but depends upon the product of the mass and the velocity. The effect is entirely due to the motion of the body, since it would not occur in the absence of motion. Thus, we can conclude that a moving body possesses some property which depends upon both its mass and velocity. This property is called momentum of the body and quantified by the product of the mass and the velocity. Newton's second law of the motion can also be explained through billiards. The rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the impressed force and takes place in the direction in which the force acts. Here, as one hits the ball goes in straight line. Similarly, for the rolling motion, rotational momentum and angular momentum are the quantities which change only if torque is present. Basically, what happens here is that if the force is acting through the center of the mass or the center of gravity, as it is commonly called, then there will not be any chance of producing what we can call as a spinning motion. But if the force is not acting through the center of mass, then a torque is produced. This torque then results in the spinning motion of the body. In the case of a pendulum experiment, which has been shown here, you can see that suddenly, as one pendulum is allowed to start moving, it goes and hits the other pendulums at rest. Due to the impact, only one other pendulum will lift up and will go through the motion. The same is also explained through billiards. You can very easily see the stroke, which is called as stop ball, also resulting in almost similar motion.
An intelligent player strikes the ball to get a particular motion of the ball. Thus, the direction in which you strike, one can anticipate the motion of the ball.
Plane striking, hitting the cue ball with dead center. Top, hitting the cue ball high up promotes extra forward rotation, contact between top and center. Bottom, hitting the cue ball low down, that is halfway between bottom and center, retards the forward motion. Stop ball, a sharp stunning stroke to make the cue ball stop dead and remain on the spot previously occupied by the object ball. Stun, similar to stop ball, a heavy deadening stroke when it is desired to leave the cue ball nearby after contact.
Newton's first two laws of motion deal with forces and their effects on the motion of objects. Newton's third law deals with the mutual interaction between two bodies. It is obvious that in order to exert a force on one body, there must be another body to exert this force. No action can be taken within a body which will result in a force on itself. But any single force is one aspect of the mutual interaction between two bodies. In fact, when a body exerts a force on a second body, the second body also exerts a force on the first body. These two forces are equal in magnitude but opposite in their directions, and they act simultaneously. This is the third law of motion. If the two equal and opposite forces act on a single body, there would not be a resulting motion, since the two forces are acting on two different bodies, both of them gain or lose momentum by equal and opposite amounts. To every action, there is always an equal and opposite reaction. Thus, every action is always accompanied by a reaction. That is, forces always exist in pairs. The action or reaction are generally shared by a system or two different bodies.
Wasn't it amazing? So students, be inquisitive and watch things with a discerning eye. Then you will be able to relate the phenomena in nature with the basic laws of science.